Silas Marner, The Weaver of Raveloe is the third novel by George Eliot, published in 1861. An outwardly simple tale of a linen weaver, it is notable for its strong realism and its sophisticated treatment of a variety of issues ranging from religion to industrialization to community. Plot summary. The novel is set in the early years of the 19th century. Silas Marner, a weaver, is a member of a small Calvinist congregation in Lantern Yard, a slum street in northern England. He is falsely accused of stealing the congregation's funds while watching over the very ill deacon. Two clues are given against Silas, a pocket knife, and the discovery in his own house of the bag formerly containing the money. There is the strong suggestion that Silas' best friend, William Dane, has framed him, since Silas had lent his pocket knife to William shortly before the crime was committed. Lots are drawn in the belief, shared by Silas, that God will direct the process and establish the truth. However, Silas is proclaimed guilty. The woman Silas was to marry breaks their engagement and instead marries William. With his life shattered, his trust in God lost and his heart broken, Silas leaves Lantern Yard and the city for a rural area where he is unknown. Marner travels south to the Midlands and settles near the rural village of Raveloe in Warwickshire, where he lives isolated and alone, choosing to have only minimal contact with the residents. He throws himself into his craft and comes to adore the gold coins he earns and hoards from his weaving. One foggy night, the two bags of gold are stolen by Dunstan, Dunsey, Cass, a dissolute younger son of Squire Cass, the town's leading landowner. Silas then sinks into a deep gloom, despite the villagers' attempts to aid him. Dunsey immediately disappears, but little is made of this by the community because he had vanished several times before. Godfrey Cass, Dunsey's elder brother, also harbors a secret past. He is married to, but estranged from, Molly Farron, a laudanum addicted working-class woman living in another town. This secret prevents Godfrey from marrying Nancy Lamater, a young middle-class woman. On a winter's night, Molly tries to make her way to Squire Cass's New Year's Eve party with her two-year-old girl to announce that she is Godfrey's wife. On the way, she lies down in the snow and passes out. The child wanders away and into Silas' house. Silas follows her tracks in the snow and discovers the woman dead. When he goes to the party for help, Godfrey heads outdoors to the scene of the accident, but resolves to tell no one that Molly was his wife. Molly's death, conveniently for Godfrey and Nancy, puts an end to the marriage. Silas keeps the child and names her Eppy, after his deceased mother and sister, both named Hephzibah. Eppy changes Silas' life completely. Silas has been robbed of his material gold, but thinks that he has it returned to him symbolically in the form of the golden-haired child. Godfrey Cass is now free to marry Nancy, but continues to conceal the fact of his previous marriage, and child, from her. However, he aids Marner in caring for Eppy with occasional financial gifts. More practical help and support in bringing up the child is provided by Dolly Winthrop, a kindly neighbor of Marner's. Dolly's help and advice assist Marner not only in bringing up Eppy, but also in integrating them into village society. 16 years pass, and Eppy grows up to be the pride of the village. She has a strong bond with Silas, who through her has found a place in the rural society and a purpose in life. Meanwhile, Godfrey and Nancy mourn their own childless state, after the death of their baby. Eventually, the skeleton of Dunstan Cass, still clutching Silas' gold, is found at the bottom of the stone quarry near Silas' home, and the money is duly returned to Silas. Shocked by this revelation, and coming to the realization of his own conscience, Godfrey confesses to Nancy that Molly was his first wife and that Eppy is his child. They offer to raise her as a gentleman's daughter, but this would mean Eppy would have to forsake living with Silas. Eppy politely but firmly refuses, saying, "I can't think of no happiness without him." Silas revisits Lantern Yard, but his old neighborhood has been swept away in the intervening years and replaced by a large factory. No one seems to know what happened to Lantern Yard's inhabitants. However, Silas contentedly resigns himself to the fact that he will never know and now leads a happy existence among his self-made family and friends. In the end, Eppy marries a local boy she has grown up with, Dolly's son Aaron. Aaron and Eppy marry and move into Silas' house, which has been newly improved courtesy of Godfrey. Silas' actions through the years in caring for Eppie have apparently provided joy for everyone, and the extended family celebrates its happiness. Thank you.